Okay, let's go. So welcome everybody. Tonight's our second International UKIP Live faculty focused on foot and ankle. So tonight we welcome Dr. Chris Butz from Anvert in Belgium. So if you attended the first session, you know that UKIP, we've been engaging, working extensively on foot and ankle projects for the last 5 years now. So it gives us always the possibility to meet people internationally and develop new partnerships focused on developing new products and trying to bring some new standard of care to orthopedics. So we met with Chris some time ago now, and while discussing together, we recognized the potential of bringing our partnership to the next level. Dr. Chris Butz, that you might well know, is a member of the board of the EFAS and is a specialist of the in-foot pathologies as well as the ankle. So thank you, Chris, for joining us tonight, especially after your busy program of the afternoon already. So you're just out of the OR. And so whenever you're ready, you can start with your presentation.
Okay. Thank you. Do you hear me?
Yes, perfectly well.
Okay. So, good evening, everybody. Thank you for the invitation. I'd like to share some thoughts of me, how I treat my flat foot surgery. Oh, it has to go forward. Well, if you want to see this decision tree, then probably it's not what I'm going to say. I want to try and talk a bit about the osseous corrections in flexible flat foot deformities, going to hind foot and what I normally do for my corrections to the medium column, what I think it's very important to correct as well, as I'll talk a little bit on soft tissues and how to correct them, which can be very important on the medial side, as you know, and some new insights about the spring ligament and deltoid who are confluent and actually can behave as one and only ligament. So if you go to the medial column is something that has to be stable and has to be able to absorb energy, but also to transduce energy afterwards. So it's something that is flexible, but at the same time has to be rigid. And you have some arches, let everybody know, the lateral part of the foot can be very rigid. Sometimes the medial has to be adapted for the when going from stance to push off, and if you transverse arch as well, that gives some stability and can absorb energy as well. So if you see about flat foot, it's mainly everybody's talking about the TBL's posterior tendon, which can be sick, can be diseased, and can have a less of function. And if you know what it does, it gives an eccentric contraction in the early stance of phase where it unlocks the foot. So it's able to adapt to an uneven surface. But then if you start to work, it goes to a subtalar inversion and then it locks. So it's getting energy and then it transfers energy again to the forefoot when you go to the push off. And that's actually what's happening. If you go in your stance phase, you see if you start putting weight, then you have tensile forces on your fascia plantaris, and you have some on the dorsal part of your foot, you have compressive forces. So it's actually a very high level and very ingenious adaptive mechanism that your foot has between stable and loose. And that means that all those structures that are involved in this adaptive mechanism can fail. And that's why you have so different, I think, a different kind of flat foot, because all those different structures, they have their own pathology and they can fail. So why we know that from the literature, we know that flat foot surgery is quite a good outcome if you don't do orthodesis. And probably it's because if you make your foot too stiff, patients cannot adapt to an uneven surface anymore. They cannot walk in sand anymore. So they're not so satisfied with what you did as a surgeon, even if you can address the hind foot malalignment well. But so that's why probably we have to be sure to detect the deformity early and get to a deformity correction, which give a nice balanced foot, but also which is stable. And that probably will prevent to a painful osteoarthritis and a painful rigid deformity of your foot. We have to talk a little bit of, about the anatomy. I'm not going to say a lot, but we know that the tibialis posterior tendon originates in the proximal one-third of the tibia and the membrana interossea. It makes a turn around the medial malleolus, and that's a quite avascular zone of the tendon. And then classically, everybody's talking that you have three parts, an anterior part, a middle part that inserts to a little bit more medial, and then the posterior part that goes to your system tecum tali. But the recent study about the anatomy shows this. I mean, there's a lot of variety in your insertion of your tibialis posterior tendon. And that's why probably if I'm using a lot of weight-bearing CT scan, and that's why we see in the weight-bearing CT scan, we see a lot of different deformities that you cannot explain just by one tendon or just by one diseased structure inside the foot. So if you go to the clinical signs, everybody knows it very well, you can have a hindfoot valgus, you get the foot abducted, and you can have a residual forefoot varus. And we know that all those deformities, they can be flexible or rigid. And most part in the beginning, they're flexible, but the longer you wait with treatment, they can get rigid and painful. So why sometimes your decision fails also? If you go, if you see this foot, it was corrected, but it still is medial arch was not completely redressed, although the surgeon did double osteotomy on the calcaneum, and he had a cotton osteotomy, but it failed. And if you go back to the history and you see his MRI scan, you see it's actually not a flexible foot. It's a rigid hind foot. He had a subtalar coalition, which makes that you cannot correct completely with only periarticular osteotomies. You cannot correct completely this foot. So we have to first to be sure that your foot, if you want to treat it with osteotomies and deformity correction, you have to be sure that it's a flexible deformity. So you go to your hind foot. I don't know if the movie will play. You look at the joints, and you have to get an apprehension of your subtalar movement. Also, you can look at mostly people with the tip posterior tendon disease, they will have problems going on tiptoes. But if by podal heel raise, you see a mobility of the hind foot with the supination and varus in the hind foot. Also, your forefoot, you can address the flexibility. If you keep your lateral raise in your hand and you start to move with your first ray, that you can see it's a hypermobile or it's rigid. So it's something very easy to do in a clinical exam to see if you have a flexible deformity. A second thing when always look at is my Achilles tendon and my gastrocnemius. So everybody knows about the silver skull test, but you have to know why you test it. You test that your mobility is right because your Achilles tendon can be a part of the disease itself. So if you correct your valgus in your hind foot and you do a silver skull test and you get an ankle dorsiflexion with the knee flexed, your ankle dorsiflexion get better, then you know it's a gastrocnemius problem. If it's an Achilles problem, then with the knee flexed, you still get some problem with the dorsiflexion. And it's important to do it with the valgus corrected in the hind foot. And that's what my belief is. We have a foot with walks and it goes from supple to rigid during gait. That means that your foot can store energy, but it also can liberate energy. And that's done to the ligaments and tendons. And those are the adaptive mechanism. And all those failures can make ligaments and tendons, they can, at some stage, they can fail, which can be a reason why you have your deformity and why your deformity can go from flexible to rigid. So we know your Achilles tendon, if your foot goes in inversion and you get the valgus, then your Achilles tendon and you will actually get a net eversion vector. So it make your pathology worse. Also, what will happen with your fascia plantaris is that when it stretches out, you have you have no talar bracing anymore, so you have less storage of energy when you go to your push-off. And if you have your metatarsal ligaments, they get overloaded, then you get the secondary deformity through the forefoot abduction, sometimes the equinus, and a compensation forefoot supination. But don't forget, it's not only about the tibialis posterior. And if you go into the literature for the moment, a lot of people are, there are schools saying that you don't have to address your soft tissues on the medial side. You just have to do your bony corrections. I don't think it's completely true. You have, it's not about the posterior alone. You have your fascia plantaris, which avoids plantar lengthening, your spring ligament, which serves as a hammock where your talar head is resting in, and it prevents sagging of your talus, but it also reduces your hindfoot pronation, and probably your tip posterior assists your spring ligaments. So you also have to know, which is a factor that for me is important, that your talus is like squeezed in between your calcaneum and your tibia, and it's like a bony meniscus. You don't have any muscular attachments to your talus, but it means that it's very it's congruent because it's squeezed into a quite congruent joint, but it's only stabilized by ligaments and the aponephrosis tissue. So it's important that you know if you have problems around it and it fails at certain stage, that your talus can get tilted, and your talus also can be part of the pathology. And especially if you look at the form of your talus, of your posterior facet, about 88% is convex, which means actually that it directs more into valgus. If you have a rounded subtalar joint posterior and get a valgus deformity, then it glides more into valgus, and it can be also a cause or a reason, and it's all about, we don't know it very well, but it can an instability related to your spring ligament rupture as well. If you take this in account, then we know we had a lot of classifications, and Myerson was one of the most that people use. There are some modifications, but it cannot explain every deformity that you see in a flat foot. Haddad in 2011 made a little bit more comprehensive, going into stage two, going in different sub stages where you look at the supination of your foot and also abduction of your foot. But the river people are going further than Blackwood in 2018. He made a classification about the arch collapse, seeing if it's more about dynamic classification, seeing first that your gastrocnemius fails, then you have probably forefoot, can be in hypermobile first ray. He's the first talking about hallux valgus also as being part of the pathology, and then it goes to the midfoot and the hindfoot. So do we know it? I don't think so. There are a lot of factors that we're treating or don't treat, but you have to be careful. I mean, there is more in the medial side of the foot than just the valgization in the hind foot. You can have a lot of structures that can fail during your disease and when the disease gets progressive. So if you talk about the bony procedures, there's a lot of bony procedures that you can do to stabilize your foot. You have a lot of soft tissue procedures as well that you can do. And if you are what my workhorses are, then it's a medial calcaneum osteotomy. You have the lateral lengthening osteotomy. You can do your medial column restoration. And then you have also the soft tissue procedures. But the goal is that you want to create a stable tripod reconstruction again, so that your foot has the rigidity and kind of suppress as well, so it can, again, store energy, can liberate energy, and can help you to ambulate correctly without pain. So that's a little bit the theoretical part. It's how I address it. My first part is I will always probably start with calcaneum osteotomy. So you do a medial slide, it corrects your valgus, and it corrects the eversion force of your Achilles tendon. Is it enough? As an isolated procedure, it's often not enough as a isolated procedure. The principle is that you go extra-articular, you do it in 90 degrees in an axial plane and 45 degrees in a sagittal plane. But also, that's probably not so correct, because if you do a calcaneum osteotomy, you always have a medialization, but also you have an inferior displacement of your fragment. And if you do it in a moderate or in a severe hindfoot valgus, then your net result will be different in the moderate in the severe, as you see on the slides. And that's a work done by people in Ghent, the University of Ghent with Bursas. It's a you displace medial and inferior. And we know that the medial displacement gets the correction of your valgus, but the more inferior displacement that you do, you get loss of correction. So it's probably in severe preoperative valgus, if you stay on 90 degrees with your saw blade on the calcaneum, then you get less medial displacement, but you get more inferior displacement. So you get loss of correction. So probably in a severe, you have to look at the amount of valgus that you want to correct, and you have to direct your saw blade from 90 degrees to less, in depending on the deformity that you have. And that's probably also a thing that that can be done, some scientific work of trying to get guides or try to predict the outcome of your slide osteotomy. So if you see the case here, I use a lot of weight-bearing CT scan because I can do it, luckily. You have the on-coverage of your, but the mild on-coverage of your tail navicular. You have your valgus in your hind foot. And if you address it with a calcaneum slide, you get a quite nice reduction of your valgus hind foot. I will always add something on the medial side, but that will come back later on. The second workhorse is the lateral column lengthening. Was first described by Evans. Can be done alone or in combination. And the purpose is to correct the tail and navicular abduction and prevent motion in the hind foot. It's a quite powerful osteotomy, and you can easily overcorrect it, where you can, which means that you get an overload on the lateral side, and you can have a fixed supination on the forefoot. What you look at the tail and navicular on coverage, the abduction in the forefoot, but also not only on the x-ray, because sometimes people on x-rays, they don't stand correctly, or your technician will take the x-ray in a more of in a bad angle, so you don't appreciate very well the on coverage. So it's important if you're on your clinical exam, you have an abduction, and you have kind of a flexible abduction in the hind foot, then probably I won't look at my x-ray, but I will decide on do a lateral column lengthening as well. And the reason is that you want to restore your tripod again. If you see on the left side, you see what's happening with your force directions, and you want to have your foot flat again, and you want to have a good tripod again. So it's not only about getting your valgus off your hind foot, but probably you have to turn your foot a little bit around. And for me, the lateral column lengthening, it's a rotation osteotomy, so I won't do a classical Evans, but I will probably go more to the osteotomy that Hinterman describes, going at the site of the sinus tarsi, going with my saw blade onto the lateral on the medial side, and then open it up without breaking. So you have a real rotational effect on your forefoot, so you can adduct the forefoot in a rotational way to get your correction. And this means that when I started doing this and I saw the effect that it gave, I was quite happy, but sometimes people still had a residual valgus. So I was thinking about, well, it's not probably not enough. And it's a 3D deformity with your hand with valgus and abduction of some hyperlaxity. So a lot of my treatments will be about double osteotomies, meaning that I can correct the hind foot valgus with the MCO and we'll do the adduction of the forefoot with a double osteotomy. That means that I don't have to do big slides on my calcaneum, on my MCO osteotomy, and I don't have to over exaggerate with my rotation Hinterman osteotomy. And one of the reasons that I started doing this, if you see these x-rays, there was a lady who was operated for an hallux valgus, and she had pain again on her hallux valgus. She had a recurrence of her hallux valgus, but actually the x-ray was not so bad, but you see she had a flat foot. And she was sent to me to do a redo hallux valgus. But what I did actually, we did a double osteotomy on the calcaneum, with some reefing on the medial side, and you see that she corrected quite well. She's happy, she's 4 years out of surgery, is at an EVA score of 18 out of 20, or 20. So I was quite pleased with the result. Even it's not completely a normal foot, but still she's doing well. So if you do a double osteotomy, what do you do first? Because you know you can overcorrect easily on both sides. So what I will normally do, I will start with my calcaneum osteotomy, deciding on the slope of my saw blade, how I want to correct, and then leave it loose and go to my lateral column lengthening, do my hinterman, and then fix my hinterman, and then go back to my hind foot and fix my osteotomy a little bit, how I do my triple arthrodesis. If I do a triple arthrodesis, I always do a correction of my tail and avicular joint before I fix my subtalar joint. And that's why I think you can more do more in your tail and avicular joint is for me the key part of my of the foot, where you can address more the deformities. If I'm happy with the calcaneum osteotomy, then probably I will always go to my medial side. I will open it up. And it's a little bit of about my clinical exam, but also about my MRI scan that I do in the beginning. What I decide whether to, if I have an insertional tendinopathy, which is painful, which is a thickened insertion of my tendon, then probably I will do a kind of a tenodesis on the medial side. I will take a flap out of my tibial posterior tendon, and I would put it as a plasty on my spring ligament to do a reinforcement of my spring ligament. Do I do an FDL transfer? I do sometimes an FDL transfer, but not always. I do when I have a total rupture. As you see on the right side, there's a rupture because of cortisone injection. And then probably you don't know what the cause is. I will do an FDL transfer. If I have a stenosing tendinopathy, that means that you can have fatty degeneration in your muscle because of the long-standing disease. I don't think that your tendon works anymore. If you have fatty degeneration in your muscle belly, then probably I will go also for a FDL transfer. But I think that the spring ligament is something which is very important. Your spring ligament can be the main stabilizer, and there's some literature coming out that actually it does. It prevents your medial sagging. It's kind of a hammock effect of your tailor head. It reduces hind foot pronation. You have your superior band, you have your medial plantar, and your inferior plantar longitudinal band, and probably the superior medial is where the most of the pathology is. It's covered by a fibrocartilage coating that keeps your tailor head, but it's important also that it's there to separate your tip posterior tendon from your talus. And if you go in those MRI scans that you see on the left side, you see a quite normal spring ligament, and then you see the middle with a degeneration. And on the right, you see a complete rupture of your spring ligament. And if I see that on my MRI scan, then I think you need to address this, even if it's a super correctable flat, but sometimes you see it. And that's the reason why I do always an MRI scan before I start operating on my flat foot surgery. It's to appreciate a little bit what's going on the tendon side, but also on the ligament side, the deltoid, but and on the spring ligament side. Like an example here again, it's still a flexible, but you see the widening on your medial side. You had the sagging, and on the MRI scan, you see quite a complete rupture of your spring ligament. Again, an example of a case. It's a case of a lady who was operated by a medial slide osteotomy, but you see that she still have a big deformity after a medial slide osteotomy. And you see the typical knick, the abduction, and the instability on the medial part. And actually what we did, we do it, and we put a graft on the medial side. There is literature about how you should put your graft, and a two limbs graft give more stability to your spring ligament again. And it's quite the technique that I use with a grassless graft to reconstruct as well the deltoid attenuation and the spring ligament attenuation. You add everything which is necessary, and if you go, that is the pre-op x-ray and a weight bearing CT scan. There's a post-op of the same patient. I think it's quite a good result with the double osteotomy to redo the osteotomy, to stabilization of the medial column, and a complete repair of the spring ligament and deltoid ligament. So you don't always have to go in the severe deformity. deformities into a triple or a double arthrodesis, you can still do some reconstructive work if the deformity stays supple. If I do the medial side and I will go to my medial column, and I would try to recreate my tripod, and I may have three big pathologies that I find important. You can have a residual forefoot supination, but also you can have a hypermobility in your TMT1 joint. You can have an associated hallux valgus, or, and that's something that I learned a lot with using weight-bearing CT scan, you can have those sacs not only in your tail navicular joint, but also navicular cuneiform. You can have them on other parts of the foot as well. And you have a lot of treatment possibilities you can do to create your medial or stabilize your medial column. You can do it depending on what the pathology is. So a cotton osteotomy, it's a dorsal opening wedge osteotomy. It's very powerful, but you can easily get an overcorrection. So you have to be very, if you use it, you have to look at it, and you don't have to overcorrect because you get overloading of your medial arch with pain on your sesamoids and pain in your TMT1 joint. But you also can undercorrect it. And if you undercorrect it, what happens, you get an elevation of your first ray, and then you can have tensor metatarsalgia in your forefoot. The second pathology is the hypermobile first ray, as you see here, the lady with a progressive flat foot with pain in the foot, but also with an important hallux valgus and a problem on the TMT1 joint. And then if you think about this, it's also a three-dimensional deformity, but because your first metatarsal will not only go in valgus, but it rotates as well. So the only way to address this, I think, is doing a Lapidus to derotate and to plantarize your TMT1, and you get a stable medial column again. Then another, using the weight-bearing CT scan, what you can see here, you see a lady with and actually it's my mother, she had a very painful flat foot, and she had all the clinical signs of a flat foot. But when I did the weight-bearing CT scan, I saw that the navicular cuneiform joint was diseased. It was some osteoarthritis inside. So probably if you do cotton here, or you do something, or you do just your slightest, it's not enough. She still will have pain afterwards. So what we did, we did a fusion of the navicular cuneiform where we do a plantar wedge, so you restore your arch in your medial side. So if you treat those supple deformities, there's a lot that you can do. But the purpose is you have to be a stable tripod reconstruction. If it's still a flexible deformity, you can do all those corrective osteotomies. And my workers are my opinion is that you start with a with your calcaneum to get the phallicus out of your hind foot. You can get the abduction out of the hind foot with your phallicus. Probably you need a double osteotomy. You look at your Achilles tendon. If you have to do a strayer, if you have a gastroc problem, or you do a real Achilles tendon release, if you have an Achilles tendon problem. Then I will always go to my medial side and see what's going wrong there. And I want to create some kind of my soft tissues on the medial side, because I believe still in the load transmission and energy transmission. So I think it's important to reconstruct it a little bit on the medial side. And then I will always do a look at my medial column, see if it's stabilized also. And sometimes you have to add a cotton osteotomy or a Lapidus, or even go to an arthrodesis. So I think that's what I wanted to share. If there are any questions.
It was very clear, honestly. I had a lot of questions for you, but it was very clear, so I'm not seeing any question in the conversation. I have one question on my side. Do you think, I mean, from a company part, do you think there is a space for dedicated cutting guides in that kind of osteotomy, let's say for Malerba osteotomies, or do you think there is a space for that kind of instrument?
Yeah, I think so. if you go to your calcaneum osteotomy, there is a place to guide your osteotomy, to know where it slides and to see how much it goes in a valgus osteotomy, to see how far it goes downwards, because the more it goes downwards, the less correction you have in your valgus. So yes, I think there is a way to develop a good preoperative planning and also a patient-specific guides to address it. And even if you think about it, if you take some foot and you the different degrees of valgus, you can even think about plates. It's not only about the osteotomy, but you can even guide your osteotomy by a different angle degree in your plate. So yes, I think there is some evidence that it can work.
That's very interesting. Okay, well.
Is it changing the postoperative protocol then, Chris? If you use a more precise guide or a plate instead of screws or stuff like this? Do you allow more to the patient?
Well, my postoperative plan doesn't change, I think. I do want it that it's stable. That means that I will always give 2 weeks of a back slap just to let the wounds heal. And then people start working in a fracture brace. And that's because of the stability that you have inside your osteotomy and the fixation that you do. I think the fixation is important. The fact that you don't use big grafts, like for the lateral column lengthening, you see less necrosis of your graft. So if you do a double osteotomy, you're less depending on the bone grafts that you put inside. You get better bone healing because your deformity correction is done on both sides of your calcaneum. So it's a quite stable construct.
Okay, thank you. So we have a question from Marco Lopez tonight that is bringing that he's done a few Evans and a few MCBO, but he's always performing cotton as an associated procedure. So the question is, when do you believe, Chris, that cotton could be avoided? And when do you perform soft tissue procedures after bony procedures?
Cotton, I think it's a very powerful tool if you have a isolated forefoot supination after your surgery. If you have a hypermobile joint, I think cotton is not a good solution. If you have some osteoarthritis inside your joints, cotton probably is not a good solution as well, because you transfer your load, you get it's a very powerful plantar flexion osteotomy. So in my hands, the cotton is only if you have a residual forefoot supination, which is supple, without any joint involvement and without any hypermobile problems. Because you have a hypermobile problem and you put it too much downward, you get hyperpressure, you tend to do a hypercorrection as well. So the cotton, I mean, that's why in my protocol, I will try to find on my middle column the three different types that I believe are important for my forefoot supination, hypermobility of my first ray, or a sagging which is elsewhere than in the than on the classical tail navicular part of the joint. So if you have a navicular cuneiform joint, I don't think a cotton will help. Then I think it's better to do an arthrodesis, because you put even your sag more downwards if you do it. And for the soft tissue, I will always, I will first do my calcaneum osteotomies, and then I go on my medial side. And depending on my pre-op exam and on my MRI scan, I decide probably what to do. And people, my fellows, or they always see, I will probably always do a kind of a flap of my insertion tendinopathy, which is diseased tendon. I will make a little flap of it, which I suture onto the spring ligament. Instead of doing an imbrication that is described, that you do an imbrication of your spring ligament, or you do a kind of a suturing, but I will always put a part of my tibial tendon on as an extra support on my spring ligament. If I have a spring ligament in my pre-op work, I have a flexible flat foot with a spring ligament rupture, I will go for spring ligament reconstruction and probably won't do a tip posterior reconstruction. It's only when I have a complete rupture due to injection, or if you open it up and the tendon pops out which is an acute rupture on the insertion site, then probably I will do a transfer of my FDL.
Well,
thank you, Pete.
Thank you very much. We have another question from Paolo Amado. Hello, Paolo. We are glad to see you here.
Oh. Hello, thank you.
Hello, how are you doing?
Everything okay? Thank you, parents. Hello.
Thank you. So we have a very interesting question. Do you think there is there any place for arthrosis and in adults?
I don't know. I was looking at literature and there is some evidence, but I was raised in, or my schooling is typically Belgium schooling. We're not used to using arthrosis, so I've never tried it. I've taken some out because of pain and synostasis. And the philosophy behind is quite okay. I mean, like the subtalar joint and the talonavicular joint, the coxapeges is a quite supple problem. So if you have simple deformity and you can, in a three-dimensional way, putting something in the synostasis, you can recreate the normal alignment, then probably yes. But I find it very difficult. I mean, it's nothing that I would do. And some people use it as a protection of their reconstruction. But I think it's then you're adding something else more, which can be possibly painful. So I don't know. I've never used it. I just take it out.
Okay. Thank you. And we have another question from Paolo. Do you have, so I think you are more a screw user for calcaneal osteotomy. And I know that that Paolo is a plate user. Do you think you have the same stability, or why are you using more screw, or what are your feeling regarding this?
The reason why I use screws is because I combine often my osteotomies doing a double and a Hinterman osteotomy, and it's easier to fix with two screws than using two plates on the lateral side. I mean, if you use a plate for your Hinterman osteotomy and a plate on the lateral side, it's very complicated and it can be very bulky. That's why I'm using two screws, and yeah, it's stable. That's not a problem because you get a construct, one going a little bit more 45 degrees, one goes flat to the CC joint, so it's really a stable construct.
Okay. Can you hear me? No.
Yeah, Paolo. Hi, Paolo.
May I say, okay, I agree with you. Hello, Chris. Thank you for fantastic explanation, because you explain everything in a flat foot in adult, and is a very nice talk. And but I think it's my experience. I use it always plate because it's so different the strong. I discover when I use the screws that must have almost 80% of my patient lost something. I have 10 millimeters of sliding, and when I saw the X-ray 15 days ago, I have a bad surprise in some cases. If you use a screw, I agree with you. You must use it always two, minimum two, in my opinion. But if in the plate you never lost what you pretend, is one opinion. So in some cases, I use it screw from a plate from osteotomy calcaneum in same patient, a plate for Evans, and in the same patient arthrosis, because in a flat foot, like you show in some cases, the really strong deformity, I think is more secretive for me, and I prefer. I have five cases with arthrosis also. This is what I do with the answers. But I agree with you. I agree with you, because if you in the screws, you can fix at the same time calcaneal osteotomy and Evans osteotomy. I agree with Evans or osteotomy.
Okay. One of the reasons why I used the screws as well is a plate gives you one part of the direction of your osteotomy. It guides you always on 90 degrees of your calcaneum wall. And if you have those big deformities and you're sometimes you displace it, but you're a little bit surprised of not the correction that you have. I mean, you don't correct enough because probably you go more inferior and not enough medial. And the plate always stays in the same direction. So if plates can vary from angle instead of only 90 degrees, you get less angles that you can correct those severe deformities with the plate as well. It can be a good option. But that's the reason why I don't use a plate as well, because I'm able, or I like always to guide my osteotomy not always 90 degrees, but go less or more depending on the deformity that I have.
Yeah, and some I have also cases very interesting with a screw that damage the tibial nerve, because it's not so easy. You have about 32, 33. Of the length of the calcaneum, and if you sliding 12, for example, you have only a little space to put the screws in axial view, of course. Sometimes you see you control your patient with a profile, you think it's right, but if you do axial view, you have a bad surprise. Yeah.
But I use a mini fluoroscopy, so I always check the position of my screw. And what I teach my residents as well, that if you go, instead of going central in your calcaneum, you go a little bit more lateral, you have more possibility to guide your pin, your guiding pin, so it's easier to stay out of the danger zone, not penetrate the middle part of your calcaneum.
Okay, but I agree. Thank you, Chris. Thank you.
Thank you. So we have another question from Marco Lopez. Do you prefer autograft, allograft in your Evans or Cotton's, or you prefer tantalum interpositional triangles?
I just activated your microphone, Mr. Lopez, if you want to ask your question directly as well, or to discuss, it's possible.
Hello there. Yes. Hi, do you hear me?
Hi.
Hello. Yes. Yes, we can hear you.
Hi. So when you perform Evans or Cotton, sometimes we use, in my case, I use allografts. I perform like a wedge, and I put it and I put a plate to protect that. But I would like to know if I know that I don't know if new clips have available this type of tantalum. I think it's tantalum, like sort of triangles that we can use as interpositional material.
We don't have it actually. We have plate without wedge, so you can put whatever you want under the plate in the osteotomy site. But we don't have any allograft or any tantalum triangle or stuff like that actually.
If I always use an allograft, because we have a lot of a bone tissue bank inside the hospital, so it's easy to have it. And I will make a wedge out for my Evans or for my Hinterman osteotomy. And then for my Cotton, I will use a plate with a wedge inside, and I will stuff it up with the rest of the allograft that I have. So that's the easiest part.
Because when you do it with allograft, obviously it's more work. You have to measure your wedge, and sometimes it's a bit smaller than you want.
Yeah.
But I'm not sure if with this type of tantalum wedges, if there is a union.
I don't know. I don't have any experience with it. If probably the tantalum, because it's quite porous, there will be bony ingrowth in it. So it will be, and the Evans or an Hinterman, it's stable because you have some compressions force on your osteotomy side. So I don't think it's it's a problem also for an opening wedge in your cotton, because you have compressive forces on the dorsal part. It's quite stable. Even there's some people who do an Evans or a Hinterman without any material. They should put a graft inside. And in children in pediatrics, they don't use material if they do a lateral column lengthening. Most of the surgery will just put a graft inside. But my experience is if you put a bigger graft, you get easy get osteonecrosis of your graft. So that's why I always like to stabilize it as well.
Okay, thanks a lot and very good presentation. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Well, so thank you very much, Chris. I think we don't have more questions here. Maybe we can leave our email address and if there is other question, we can go to you. But it was a very, very interesting presentation with a lot of information. Thank you for everything.
Right. Very
thank you.
Steve. Thank you very much, Chris, for
thank you. Okay. Thank you.
And thank you, everybody, for attending tonight on the presentation. And obviously, as Arthur said, don't hesitate if you have any questions post-presentation to send it to you. Arthur is just giving his address as well, and we'll be pleased to give you more information. And so I wish everybody a nice evening or a good day for US and Southern American friends.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, everybody.
Bye. Bye.